needs nerve conduction studies and workup for neuropathy. But due to your wrong localization, you may advise MRI lumbosacral spine. Some people advise MRI cervical spine. So what happens due to your wrong localization, patient undergoes unnecessary investigations. So this is why your localization is important. As far as the division of the neuraxis is concerned, it's divided into cortical brain, which you all know comprises of two cerebral hemispheres. Then comes subcortical brain, which include white matter, basal ganglia, thalamus, internal capsule. Then we have brainstem, which comprises of midbrain, pons and medulla. Cerebellum, which comprises of two cerebellar hemispheres and vermis. Spinal cord, divided into cervical and thoracic spinal cord. Then we have roots, the lumbar and sacral roots. Then peripheral nerves. And then we have neuromuscular junction. And the last one is muscle. When you start neurological examination, it has a systemic way to be performed. We start with higher cortical functions, then we proceed to cranial nerves, then cerebellar functions, motor, sensory system, deep tendon reflexes, and pathological reflexes. This is the usual sequence of your neurological examination. The neurological examination should evaluate the entire neuraxis. The higher cortical functions are mediated by cortex. If a patient has higher cortical functions impaired, it means the lesion is most likely in the cortex or supratentorial part of the brain. If you find cranial nerve deficits, it means if probably the lesion either is in the brainstem or the subcortex is involved, and sometimes even you get facial weakness in the cortical lesions as well, but that is not due to cranial nerve lesion. That is because of the supranuclear control of the cranial nerves, which is impaired when there is lesion in the cortex. That I will explain later on. Okay, then comes cerebellar function. If these are disturbed, it means cerebellum is involved. Now come to the motor deficit. As far as the motor deficit is concerned, any part of neuraxis damage can give rise to motor deficit, which can either be a monoparesis, a hemiparesis, distal weakness, proximal muscle weakness, or weakness in a single myotome, isolated paraparesis, quadriparesis, and then your examination will guide you where exactly the lesion is. Then the sensory deficits, these point to damage to the ascending tracts of the spinal cord, thalamus, subcortical tracts, and sensory homunculus. Deep tendon reflexes, these are affected if any component of the reflex arc is disturbed. For example, the afferent peripheral nerve, or if the root is lesioned, if the cord is lesioned, or the efferent peripheral nerve or muscle. In either case, deep tendon reflexes can either be hyporeflexic or hyperreflexic depending on upper or lower motor neuron type of lesion. Then we have pathological reflexes. I hope you all understand what do we mean by upper and lower motor neuron lesions. Upper motor neuron lesions are caused by cortical lesions and corticospinal tracts in the spinal cord. And lower motor neuron lesions are usually due to the nerve lesions, of the root lesions, and even the muscle also comes in the lower motor neuron type. And then we have neuromuscular junction, that is a separate presentation. So in upper motor neuron, we have subcortex, cortex, brainstem, cervical, and dorsal cord. And in the lower motor neuron, we have peripheral nerve and the radicals. Then we come to the division of the neuraxis and how we will localize the lesion. First comes the cortical brain. When you are assessing any patient with neurological symptoms, first of all, you need to determine the handedness of the person, and it will determine the hemispheric dominance. Most of the patients, they are right-handed and their left hemisphere is dominant. While in some people, they are left-handed and their right hemisphere is dominant, the first thing to ask is the handedness of the patient. Then you need to check higher mental functions. Now, what do we assess in higher mental functions? We assess patient's attention. We do ask the patient to do reverse counting, or if he cannot do the reverse counting, then he can count days of the week backward, and it assesses the attention span of the patient. Then comes orientation, orientation to time, place, and person, and then comes short-term memory. We ask him to remember three objects, like three objects which are not related to each other and which are not present in patient's surroundings, which are not related to each other. Just try to understand, you will not ask him to remember book, copy, and pen. Okay, three different objects from three different categories, and these should not be present around the patient so that he does not use his visual memory to recall those objects. And then when we do the examination, we ask him to remember these three objects, we ask him to repeat, and then after 5 minutes we ask him to recall, and this assess the short-term memory. So these were the higher mental functions. Then comes the aphasia, apraxia, and agnosia, and other cortical sensation. These are all produced by lesions of cortex. Aphasia, apraxia, agnosia. I will explain each and every point. Through detailed examination, neurologists should lateralize and localize within a lobe. Otherwise, non-neurologists, they simply localize to right or left half of the brain, and they are not able to exactly localize the lesion. But as far as the neurologists are concerned, their examination and their interpretation of the findings, it should guide them to exactly localize the lesion within a lobe or within any part of the neuraxis. I hope you all are familiar with the term aphasia. Aphasia doesn't mean absence of speech. It should rather be called dysphasia. But this is interchangeably used. You can either call it aphasia or you can call it dysphasia as well. So I think you people are aware of a few common forms of aphasia. One is Broca's aphasia, other is Wernicke's aphasia, and then comes the global aphasia. Now the Broca's aphasia, it is motor type of aphasia, and it happens with lesions in the frontal lobe, in the Broca's speech area. Now, what is Broca's aphasia? What sort of speech or language patient has? He is non-fluent, he uses few words, it's a broken speech, but his comprehension is intact. He can follow your command, he can understand your simple command, close your eyes, open your eyes, show me your tongue, he can easily follow because his comprehension is intact. Wernicke's area is intact. If only the Broca's area is damaged, his comprehension will be intact, but his fluency will not be intact. It will be a non-fluent speech, broken speech. And then we have Wernicke's aphasia, in which the patient has fluent speech, but his comprehension is impaired. He talks fluently, but it is irrelevant talk. It hardly makes any sense. It's an incoherent sort of speech. And he is fluent, but with impaired comprehension. Apparently, you will say that his speech is okay, but it is irrelevant. And he cannot interpret your command. He cannot comprehend it. When you ask him to perform simple tasks, just close your eyes, open your eyes, show me your tongue, he would be unable to do that because his comprehension is impaired due to lesion in the Wernicke's area, that is located in the temporal lobe. Temporal lobe of the dominant hemisphere. If he is right-handed, then in the left temporal lobe, if he is left-handed, in the right temporal lobe. And then comes global aphasia. Now, if there is lesion of Broca's and Wernicke's area both, what will happen? His speech will be non-fluent with impaired comprehension. His Broca's area is also gone and Wernicke's is also gone. This usually happens in large MCI infarction, which involves both the Broca's and Wernicke's areas. In this, patient can sometimes be absolutely mute, and then after some time he regains his speech, but he is non-fluent and his comprehension is impaired. So these are three main type of aphasias. Aphasia, dysphasia, it always points towards cortical lesion. Then this terminology, which I'll be going to use in the coming slides or description of different findings, visuospatial skills. What are these skills? These is visual spatial abilities. They refer to the way you relate the visual information to the space around you. Like you are using your visual spatial ability when you use a map to get from one place to another rather than relying on the directions. Or when you walk through the doorways rather than bumping into the door frames because you can assess the distance. You can drive across the road because you can judge the vehicle's distance and the speed accurately, and you don't bump into the cars and other people. And you can look at something and pick it up because you can visually assess the distance and your hand goes accurately to that item that you want. So these are visual spatial skills, and these are impaired in parietal lobe lesions. Now come cortical sensation. So what are these cortical sensations? You must have heard about the primary sensory modalities. What are these primary sensory modalities? These are touch, pain, temperature, vibration, and position sense. Whenever you are going to look for cortical sensation, like stereognosis, I'm going to explain everything. For that, it is mandatory that your patient should have his primary sensory modalities intact. Like his touch, pain, temperature, position, vibration sense has to be intact. Because if these primary sensory modalities are impaired, you cannot assess the cortical sensations properly. You will not be able to assess it, neither you should comment on it. First, look for the integrity of the primary sensory modalities and then proceed for checking the cortical sensations. And if the primary sensory modalities are impaired, severely impaired, you cannot assess the cortical sensation. If mildly impaired, then it depends on your judgment, being a neurologist, whether you want to assess that or you want to quit. Stereognosis. I'm not sure whether you have heard about this term before. It is a cutaneous and proprioceptive sensation. Steps. There are certain steps when you recognize an object, like its size, shape, form, and identification of the object. And each step, it can be assessed individually. It is tested only in the hand, and varieties, texture recognition kara sakte hain. You can give him cotton in the hand, like you can put some object in his hand, like you can put a coin in the hand and he can roll it and he can tell it's a round object, it's likely a coin. You can put a key in his hand and he can just feel it with his hand with eyes closed and he will tell you that it is a key. But if he is unable to recognize these common objects, then this loss of stereognosis is called astereognosis. And this is earliest to be affected in parietal cortex lesion. I think it's clear, stereognosis, an impairment of the sense is called astereognosis. Then the next is graphesthesia. This is very easy. This depends on your cutaneous sensation. What we do that we ask the patient to close his eyes and we write certain letters or numbers with blunt pen on finger pads, palms, and dorsum of the feet. 1 centimeter digits on finger pads and larger elsewhere. And this sense is called graphesthesia, in which you can identify a digit or a letter or a number with your cutaneous sensation, with your eyes closed, without your visual aid. This is graphesthesia. And when it is lost, it is called agraphesthesia. It is also called graph anesthesia, but we usually use the term agraphesthesia. Even the minimal impairment of primary sensory modalities may cause agraphesthesia. That's why it is important first to check for the intact primary sensory modalities, because if he already has decreased touch sensation, so he will not be able to appreciate when you write a digit on his palms or soles. Or this is why it is important to check for integrity of primary sensory modalities first before you proceed for checking the cortical sensation. Now, loss of graphesthesia or the sense of tactile movement with intact peripheral sensation implies a cortical lesion, especially when the loss is unilateral. 2-point discrimination. Now, what is 2-point discrimination? Again, it is a tactile sensation in which a patient, he can recognize with his eyes closed that he is being touched with two stimuli, two close stimuli. He can recognize 2 points, he can recognize 1 point, and he can recognize 2 points so close it feels like one. Eyes closed. With eyes closed, you need to check for it. Now, you can vary it and you can randomly decrease the distance until the patient starts to give errors. Now, 2-point discrimination, basically, we use some compass or clipper for checking the sensation, and result is recorded as the minimum distance before the patient starts to give errors. It depends on sensitivity of the area where you are checking the 2-point discrimination. For example, tip of the tongue, it is the most sensitive area and it can appreciate 2 stimuli which are at 1 millimeter distance. Then come the lips, the next most sensitive. These can recognize 2 stimuli 2 to 3 millimeter apart. And then when you come to the palms, the distance widens. Palms are less sensitive. So for 2 stimuli to be recognized, the distance had to be 8 to 12 millimeter. You don't need to remember these different values, but just to tell you that it depends upon sensitivity of the area checked. Like in the dorsum of the feet, this is least sensitive. So for 2 stimuli to be distinguished when they are placed close, they need to be at least 30 to 50 mm apart. Then only can patient recognize that these are 2 stimuli and not 1. Then sensory attention. Again, this is a parietal lobe function. What we exactly do, we ask the patient to close the eyes. We keep both his limbs on his in front of him and make him relaxed. And then what we do, that we touch right side first. You have to do it with the same stimulus. You compare 2 sides of the body. You can do it with light touch, you can do it with pinprick, but we usually perform with the light touch of a finger. You touch his right hand with one finger and you can ask which side you felt the stimulus. He can tell you right side. When you touch the left side, you will ask the patient on which side he felt the touch. He can tell you it was on the left side. But when you simultaneously touch both sides, he will miss one side if there is a parietal lobe lesion. So loss of this function, if the patient has a parietal lobe lesion, when you simultaneously touch both sides, he will miss one side. This is called sensory inattention. It is also called sensory extension, sensory neglect, and it is mostly due to a parietal lobe lesion. If there is a right-sided lesion, there would be left-sided inattention, and left-sided lesion, there will be right-sided inattention. I think it is easy. And if you have any sort of queries, you can always post it and I will answer it. Now, there are certain other types of agnosias also. And these are a little bit unusual terms, especially for fourth-year students. But for understanding the localization, cortical function, cortical sensation, you need to be aware of these. Hemineglect, lack of awareness of one half of the body. I will explain this further. Finger agnosia, inability to name or recognize finger, and it's usually a part of Gerstmann syndrome, which occurs in dominant parietal lobe lesion. Like when you interlock your fingers and you ask the patient to identify index finger of the right hand, he won't be able to do it. This is finger agnosia. And then we have anosognosia, absence of awareness or denial of the existence of the disease. It is also found in lesion of the right parietal lobe. All right. Then we proceed to a pictorial depiction of hemineglect. Can you see? This person, while shaving, he has left the right half of the face, shaved the right half of the face and left the forgot shaving the left half because he's neglecting his left half of the face. So this is hemineglect. When he is asked to draw a clock and fill it with the numbers, he is neglecting one side of the clock. He is filling the numbers on one side, and in the other picture you can see he has filled all the 12 numbers on one side and left the whole right side blank. And when he's copying a flower, he's just copied one side and left the other side. So this is hemineglect. And when he is copying a drawing, he has completely missed to draw one side of the drawing. And here you can see shaped one half of the face and left the other half. This is hemineglect. Actually, sensory inattention is a milder form of hemineglect. Now, visual disorders. In cortical lesion, also you get these field effects. When the visual cortex is damaged in the occipital lobe, what you get is hemianopia. Contralateral hemianopia, that is complete loss of the visual field of opposite side. If there is left occipital lobe visual cortex lesion, you will get right-sided hemianopia. What it is? Right temporal and left nasal. This is right visual field, no? Right temporal and left nasal. This is right-sided homonymous hemianopia. When is right visual cortex occipital lobe lesion, there is left-sided hemianopia, that is left temporal and right nasal. And when there are lesions in the temporal and parietal lobe, these also called visual field effects, but these are not complete homonymous hemianopias. These are actually quadrantonopias. It depends on the fibers which are passing through these lobes. So in parietal lobe lesion, patient has inferior quadrantonopia, and in temporal lobe lesion, patient has superior quadrantonopia. Now comes apraxia. Now what is apraxia? Apraxia is loss of the ability to execute previously learned activities in the absence of weakness, ataxia, sensory loss, or extrapyramidal derangement that would be adequate to explain the deficit. What does it mean? Patient does not have any sort of motor weakness. He does not have ataxia. He does not have sensory loss. And he doesn't even have any rigidity or tremor. But he is unable to perform the previously learned activities like combing the hair. I will explain and I will give you the example. Now the plan or commanded action is normally first conceptualized in the parietal lobe of the language dominant hemisphere, where visual, auditory and somatostatic information is integrated. That is a space-time plan, which is impaired, and that's why the person is unable to do it. There are many types of apraxias, but at this level you don't need to go into the details of apraxias. I will just give you some example how to look for apraxias. Now you should observe the actions of a patient while he engages in simulated task. You need to ask the patient to carry out symbolic acts like waving a goodbye. Now who doesn't know how to wave a goodbye? But if he has parietal lobe lesions, he won't be able to do it. It's a very simple thing when you ask some patient who has no sensory motor cerebellar deficit to wave a goodbye, he won't be able to do it. Ask him to salute, he won't be able to do it. Lower kiss, he won't be able to do it. Now, once the patient is not able to do it, your acts, these symbolic acts, you can ask the patient to imitate the acts. You can do the act yourself and then you can ask him to imitate. He may not be able to do it as well. Then you can ask him to do more complex tasks, like you can simulate taking out comb from your pocket and you ask him to comb the hair, brush the teeth, hammer a nail. These are very simple tasks which in the absence of any motor sensory deficit patient should be able to do it. But because there is problem in the integration of information, he has forgotten how to do it. He is unable to do it. He is unable to integrate the information and do it, though he doesn't have any deficit, any motor sensory coordination deficit. You can place a comb in his hand and ask him to comb his hair and he won't be able to do it. This is apraxia. Now, then there are dressing apraxias. What is dressing apraxia? If you turn a patient's shirt inside out and you ask him to wear it, he won't be able to do it. This is such a simple task. Now you can see in this picture, she is wearing pants on his head instead of shirt. This is pants. So what is it? It is not exactly a true apraxia, but it is rather a combination of spatial disorientation and visuospatial inattention. As I've already mentioned, visuospatial functions, when you are assessing distance and you are assessing an object with its dimensions and integrate all that information, when it is impaired, you are unable to do it. Okay, so now we come to different lesions produced different deficits produced when the different parts of the cortical brain are lesioned. For example, come to the frontal lobe, when there is a left, if the person is right-handed, we are supposing here that the person is right-handed, so the left hemisphere is dominant. Now in the left dominant hemisphere lies Broca's area, and he will have Broca's aphasia, and he will have right hemiparesis because the motor area also lies in the frontal lobe. Okay, so that is and right or left. Now Broca's is confined to the dominant hemisphere, and right or left means either the right is damaged or the left is damaged. If the motor homunculus is disturbed, patient will have hemiparesis. Okay, precentral gyrus has the motor area, and patient will have hemiparesis. And it depends whether the face and arm are more involved, or if the medial frontal lobe is involved, then the leg will be more involved. It depends on different vascular territories and different part of the motor homunculus which are affected. Now there lies the supplementary motor cortex, which causes the eyes and head to turn to one side. And then we have prefrontal cortex as well, which can cause personality disorder. And there is a cortical inhibition of voiding, which is done through the frontal lobe. In infants, this inhibition is not activated. So you must have noticed that the infants, they maturate anywhere. So till this inhibition gets the effect, when he grows up, and then due to this cortical inhibition of voiding, he tends to find a suitable place for voiding. But when this cortical brain is lesioned, the frontal lobe, patient can develop incontinence. That is impairment of impairment of cortical inhibition of voiding. Then come to the parietal lobe. Now the right parietal lobe lesions, these can produce anosognosia, left hemi neglect, dressing and constructional apraxia, and geographic apraxia. Dressing we have already discussed. Constructional, when you ask them to draw two pentagons, he won't be able to do it. And geographic apraxia, he is unable to find the path. Maybe in his own home, he is unable to find different rooms. That is geographic apraxia. Or he is unable to drive to the known places. He is unable to assess the directions. That is geographic apraxia. Then if the left parietal lobe is lesioned, patient developed Gerstmann syndrome. It comprises of left-right confusion. Left-right may recognize nahi karega. Finger agnosia. Again, he won't be able to name the different fingers. Now, that interlocking fingers examination that I told you, it checks both left-right confusion as well as finger agnosia. Because what I asked, that you just interlock your fingers and you ask the patient to identify index finger of right hand. In this way, you are checking his left-right confusion and you are checking for finger agnosia. So that's one thing. Then he is acalculia. He is unable to do calculation, like perform the simple calculations. And there is agraphia without alexia. He is able to write, but he is unable to read. Alexia is inability to read. Agraphia is inability to write. He is agraphic, but he is able to read. He cannot write, but he can read. That is left parietal lobe lesion. This is little more detailed for you, but I thought I should include it. You should know these terms and parietal lobe functions and all. Then we have parietal lobe lesion. So two-point discrimination, loss of two-point discrimination, it can occur with either parietal lobe lesion. Asteriognosis can occur with either parietal lobe lesion, and sensory inattention, that is also not particular to one lobe. It can occur with both, any of the parietal lobe lesion. Then we come to the temporal lobe, and as I told you, the Wernicke's area lies in the dominant temporal lobe. We assume that the patient is right-handed and it is lying in the left temporal lobe, so patient will have Wernicke's aphasia. That is, he will be unable to comprehend your verbal commands without impairment of hearing. With hearing intact, he is unable to comprehend. Then in either of the temporal lobe, there can be memory problems, there can be olfaction issues, and there can be sometimes auditory hallucinations as well, which can occur in epilepsy and many other, like limbic encephalitis and all. So this can occur with any temporal lobe lesion. Then come the occipital lobe that I've already told you, either right or left. It can give rise to homonymous hemianopia, loss of one visual field on the contralateral side, and it can lead to visual hallucinations and inability to recognize familiar faces. That is prosopagnosia. That also can occur with occipital lobe lesion. And what happens if both occipital lobe visual cortices are lesions? The patient should ideally be blind. Yes, he loses the vision. There is vision loss with normal pupillary reaction. Why normal pupillary reaction? Because the optic nerve and the oculomotor nerve, these are all intact. The cortex is gone. There is a syndrome which is usually described with these bilateral visual cortex lesion, that is Anton syndrome. That is, patient is blind because of bilateral occipital lobe lesion, but he denies obvious blindness. He cannot see, but he denies it. That is particularly known as Anton syndrome. Now comes neurological examination when cortical brain is lesion. We already know which lobe produce which sort of signs. So in higher cortical function, you need to look for higher mental function, aphasia, apraxia, agnosia, hemianopias, and you will identify which lobe is lesion. Now the cranial nerves, these are usually normal if isolated cortical brain lesion, except you can get visual field effect. These are not due to cranial nerve lesion, but these are due to the damage to the visual cortex or the fibers. Okay, now little explanation I would like here. What happens in a stroke? You must have seen that when there is hemiparesis, for example, there is a left frontal lobe lesion or left MC infarction, we can simply say. There is right hemiparesis with right upper motor neuron type facial weakness. What is that upper motor neuron type facial weakness? It is not due to cranial nerve damage. It is due to problem in the corticobulbar innervation of the facial nerve. Now, what is that upper motor neuron type of facial weakness and what is lower motor neuron? What happens that this corticobulbar innervation in upper part of the face, it is bilateral. Upper half is that's why is spared, because it is innervated bilaterally by that corticobulbar innervation. In the lower part, it has unilateral corticobulbar impulses from the cortex to the facial nerve. That's why when the cortex is damaged, the upper part of the face, it is spared due to bilateral innervation, and the lower half of the face is involved, and we call it upper motor neuron type of facial weakness. While when the facial nerve itself is damaged in the fascicle or in the nucleus, in the brainstem, it produces weakness of whole one half of the face, including impairment in the eye closure and the wrinkling on the forehead. That is all impaired because here the whole face is involved. One facial nerve gone, right to left, it produces same-sided whole facial weakness of same half of the face. I hope this is clear, because this sometimes causes confusion. And in higher, when the cortical brain is lesion, cerebellar function has to be normal. Motor weakness, if the lesion has hit the motor homunculus, sensory abnormalities, if it has hit the sensory homunculus, and deep tendon reflexes, yes, hyperreflexia. It is upper motor neuron type, so it will have hyperreflexia, depending either it is right hemiparesis, left hemiparesis, or then patient can have extensor plantaris, that comes in the pathological reflexes. In the subcortical brain, now subcortical brain, as I have told you, it comprises of white matter. Here you can see these are the basal ganglia and thalamus, amygdala, hippocampus. This is all part of subcortical brain. Internal capsule. So deep white radiating fibers, these produce equal involvement. These lesions produce equal involvement of face, arm, and leg. When the motor fibers, these are interrupted in the internal capsule or in the white matter, these produce equal involvement of face, arm, and leg. So there is dense hemiplegia, and sensory abnormalities depends if the sensory fibers are involved. Now if the visual radiating fibers are interrupted, if parietal lobe mein in fibers interrupted hain to inferior quadrant anopia hoga, that is the mnemonic that I told you, PITS, P-I-T-S, parietal inferior temporal superior. For temporal lobe lesion, there will be pie in the sky. What does it mean? Superior quadrant anopia. So remember that mnemonic, PITS, parietal inferior and temporal superior. Okay, so what will happen if the patient has lesion in the subcortical lesion? Higher cortical function, those will be normal. What are those? If there will be no aphasia, no apraxia, no agnesia, higher mental function will be intact. Cranial nerve, yes, visual field cuts can be there. Cerebral function is usually normal. Motor weakness, usually dense hemiplegia. Sensory, again, depends if the sensory fibers are involved. Deep tendon reflexes, again, corticospinal tract is involved. Corticospinal fibers are involved, so there will be hyperreflexia and extensor plantaris. So this was about subcortical. In subcortical lesion, no cortical signs you will find, like aphasia, apraxia, agnosia, or higher mental function disturbed. Then come to the brainstem. So what exactly is brainstem? You know, midbrain, pons, and medulla. And what does it contain? It contains the cranial nerves except the first and second, that is the olfactory and optic, which directly originate from the brain. And brain stem lesion, they have cranial nerve abnormalities, and as you know, it has the corticospinal tract, just like the spinal cord. It is basically extension of the spinal cord. So patient can have a spinal cord complaints. I will just explain every deficit of the cord as well. Then he can have a bowel and bladder problems. Why? Because the in pons there is micturition center as well, and there will be long tract sign. What are long tract sign? Same upper motor neuron signs, hemiparesis, maybe quadriparesis, depending on the site of the lesion, and there will be hyperreflexia, there will be extensor plantars, and signs can be bilateral, and there are crossed. What do we mean by crossed? What happens when there is a lesion in the brainstem, and for example, we just take an example of a pontine lesion. You know, 6 and 7 nerve nuclei, these lie in the pons. So what will happen if there is a right half of the pons is involved because of any vascular lesion? Patient may have 6, 7th, or maybe both 6 and 7 nerve palsies on the same side of the lesion, and he will have contralateral hemiparesis. Why? Because the corticospinal tracts cross to the opposite side and cranial nerves don't cross. So cranial nerve deficit on the same side and hemiparesis on the opposite side. This is what we call as crossed hemiplegia. So corticospinal tract will give you motor signs, hemiparesis, and spinal thalamic tracts, if these are involved, it will give you pain temperature disturbance, and dorsal column, if involved, this will give proprioception. Dorsal column, they are signed to go in the medial lemniscus. So that will give you a deficit in the proprioception and vibration. So when the brainstem is lesion, again, we will start from higher cortical function, normal. Cranial nerve, you will get deficit depend upon which cranial nerve is lesion. If third, fourth, sixth nerve is lesion, there will be diplopia, and there will be certain eye movement restriction depending on the which cranial nerve is involved, which cranial nerve is damaged. For example, six is damaged, so there will be abduction restriction. And if third, then you will have restriction of upward movement, medial, and downward movement as well. And then with fifth nerve, you will have decreased facial sensations, and you will also have weakness in the chewing muscles of mastication, like masseter and temporalis, and jaw deviation can be there. And with seventh nerve, as I have told you, weakness of the same side, holes of half of the face on the same side. Eighth nerve, deaf and dizzy. 9, 10, 12, dysarthria, dysphagia. And the last one, that is a spinal accessory. 11, this decreased strength in neck and shoulder. And 12th, hypoglossal is missing here, that will cause weakness of the tongue, one half of the tongue. Cerebellar function, they can be normal or affected, and depends if any cerebellar tract is involved. And motor, hemi or quadriparesis, again depends with this upon the site of the lesion, and it is always upper motor neuron type. Sensory, hemi dysesthesias. Pain temperature, as you know, is spinal thalamic tract, these cross on the opposite side, so that will be contralateral, and the vibration position will be affected on the same side. And deep tendon reflexes, there will be hyperreflexia, hemi, or generalized depending on the site of the lesion, and Babinski's reflex. This will I will further explain in my lecture on stroke, and I will tell you about different syndromes of brainstem. So I think we will be more clear about it, and when you go through that lecture. Now comes cerebellum. The function of cerebellum is basically coordination or balance. So when you examine for cerebellar function, we start from head to toe. So when you start from the head, you in the eyes you look for nystagmus, in the speech you look for dysarthria, in limbs you look for hypotonia, for intentional tremor, for impaired finger, nose and heel shin test, and you look for the white base distance and gait. And there would be truncal ataxia also if there is a lesion of the vermis of the cerebellum. This is very easy. If there is isolated cerebellar lesion, you will find your higher cortical function normal, cranial nerves normal, cerebellar functions are also normal. Cerebellar function patient will have nystagmus and scanning his speech, and motor signs, that is the hypotonia and finger nose test impaired. This is called simply dysmetria, appendicular dysmetria, or dysmetria is in coordination basically. Intentional tremor, that will be on the ipsilateral side. Please remember this. In cerebellum, there is no crossed sign or contralateral sign. Always the sign will be on the side of the lesion. Right cerebellar lesion, right-sided sign. Left-sided, both bilateral sign. Sensory normal, deep tendon reflexes are normal, and pathological reflexes are not present. Now, when we come to the spinal cord is divided into two parts, that is cervical and dorsal cord. And the signs depend on which part of the cord is lesion and their weakness below the lesion. Either it is paraparesis if the lesion is in the thoracic spinal cord, and quadriparesis when there is lesion in the cervical spinal cord. Lower motor neuron signs are the level of the lesion, and upper motor neuron sign below the lesion. Sometimes this is so confusing. Now let me explain this. For example, there is a lesion at C5-6 level of the spinal cord. What are lower motor neuron signs basically? Lower motor neuron signs are decreased reflexes, decreased tone, decreased power, vesting. These are all lower motor neuron signs. So when you look at the site of the lesion that I told you, C5-6, it carries which reflex? Biceps and brachioradialis. So when the C5-6 root is lesion, patient may have diminished bicep or brachioradialis reflex. And below that, he will be quadriparetic with all the upper motor neuron sign. If the lesion is at the C7, C8, now C7 carries tricep reflex. So the tricep reflex will be either diminished or absent, and below that, he will have all the upper motor neuron signs. This is how it works. It applies more at the cervical cord, not in the dorsal cord. Okay, sensory level horizontal. Now, when we talk about sensory level, it is always found on the trunk. Sensory level is never found on the limbs. It is mostly found in dorsal cord lesion and not cervical cord, because what happens that the cervical myotomes like C5, 6, 7, 8, these all go in the upper limbs. So you cannot find a level on the trunk. C5, 6, 7, even T1, it goes in the upper limb. It supplies the muscle of the upper limb. So the sensory level, it is usually found in the dorsal cord lesion. And what do we mean by a sensory level? Basically, what we do that we check the sensation. We start from the feet, and first of all, we check at a reference point. For example, at the forehead or at the sternum, and we ask the patient if he can feel the pain. We do it with a blunt pin, and when he says yes, he can feel the pain, and we ask him to compare that painful sensation when we start checking on the distal parts. Like, we start from distal parts and we check dermatome to dermatome bilaterally. We start comparing both, and we ask him whether it is similar to the previous painful stimulus applied to the sternum or face, or is it milder than that. And he may say that he is not able to feel anything, or he may say that yes, he is feeling the stimulus, but it is not as sharp as that he felt on the reference point. Now you will go up and up and up till you reach the trunk. And if at the trunk he has started feeling normal, then it means there is no sensory level. You come to the trunk and he feels normal, it means there is no sensory level. But for example, if a patient is saying that till the umbilicus he is feeling that the sensations are decreased, and above that these are as sharp as at the reference point, then the umbilicus is the sensory level, because above that the sensation is normal. So we roughly said that umbilicus is at the level of T10, Zipfi sternum at the level of T7, and nipples at the level of T5. So if the patient is like has decreased sensations or absent sensation till umbilicus, it means the level is T10. That is D10 or T10, whatever you call it, dorsal or thoracic, both are same. And if he is saying that the sensation is impaired or absent till Zipfi sternum, it means the sensory level is at T7. So they will have a sensory level and they will have bowel bladder, either it is incontinence or it is retention. Okay, now one thing that I would like to explain is sometimes what happens that there is a spinal cord damage that is quite significant, like sometimes there is extensive trauma and sometimes there are necrotizing myelitis. As I have described upper motor neurons and glossal lesion, this is not the case all the time. There is one terminology which is spinal shock, and at the start of, in the beginning of the disease, patient may have all the lower motor neurons sign due to spinal shock, and that can last for up to 4 to 6 weeks, and after that he gradually develops the upper motor neuron signs. But the other signs will guide you, definitely the history, the bowel bladder dysfunction and the sensory level, these will all guide you that this is not a peripheral nerve lesion, but it is a cord lesion. Now, spinal cord lesion, as I've already described a lot, higher cortical function, cranial nerve, cerebral are normal, motor weakness below the lesion, sensory level on the trunk, and deep tendon reflexes, hyperreflexia, except when the patient is in a spinal shock. All the patients, they are not in a spinal shock. In some cases, it can be the feature. And pathological reflexes, you will get upgoing plantar, extensor plantar. Now we come to root lesions. Root lesions, the best example is that I can give you is sciatica. Root lesion or a radiculopathy, pain is hallmark of a radiculopathy. Okay, so the patient who has sciatica, what we call in our neurological terminology is lumbosacral radiculopathy, and he typically complains of backache, which is radiating to the posterior thigh, and it aggravates on walking. Pain is hallmark of a radiculopathy, remember this. And sensory abnormalities will be found in the affected dermatome, and provocative maneuvers, they will exacerbate, like when we do the straight leg grazing test, the patient finds it painful and below 70 degrees. So that is provocative maneuvers that we use in the examination. Weakness in a myotome. Weakness will be present only in the involved myotome. For example, if there is an L5-S1 root lesion, so what will happen? There will be weakness of dorsiflexion of one side, that is foot drop on one side. So weakness will not be generalized, it will be isolated to a single myotome, or maybe if two myotomes are involved, then two. And the findings will be lower motor neuron. Again, the example is L5-S1 radiculopathy. Now what reflex your L5-S1 roots carry? S1 is carrying ankle reflex. So ankle reflex either may be diminished or it may be absent. So we will repeat, pain, sensory abnormalities in a dermatome, weakness again in a myotome, and it is asymmetric, of course, because root lesions, these are usually unilateral. They produce signs on one side, mostly, and then lower motor neuron finding. So I think we don't need to repeat it. Root lesions, motor asymmetric weakness, pain and dysesthesia is confined to a dermatome, and reflexes, hypo to A reflexia if the root carries a reflex. If it doesn't carry, like L4, L5 doesn't carry any reflex, so no reflex will be affected. Now we come to peripheral nerve. Here we will talk about only the diffuse peripheral nerve lesion, which is polyneuropathy, or what we call is peripheral neuropathy or polyneuropathy. We are assuming that this is a non-focal lesion. Okay, this is a diffuse peripheral nerve lesion, in which the weakness is distal predominant. Patient has sensory sign and symptom also, like dysesthesia or numbness. These are also distal predominant. Like we have the example of diabetic neuropathy, in which patient has Glavin-Stocking type sensory impairment, and the weakness, if any, which can occur later, is distal predominant lesion. Okay, so neurological examination, you can see motor weakness. These higher cortical, cranial nerve, cerebellar all have to be normal in a diffuse peripheral nerve lesion. Okay, motor and sensory symptoms, these are distal, deep tendon reflexes, of course, it's a lower motor neuron lesion, so there is loss of reflexes and there will not be any pathological reflexes. Plantars are either downgoing or mute. Now, when we talk about the nerve lesions, we do have individual nerve lesions also. For example, radial nerve palsy, patient comes with a wrist drop. The type of lesion is same. It is a lower motor neuron lesion, but as it is only one nerve is affected, so it is giving you very localized findings. Sometimes what happens that multiple nerves are involved in different extremities. For example, wrist drop on one side, foot drop in the other side. So this kind of presentation is known as mononeuritis multiplex, which has various pathologies, including diabetes, vasculitis, and lots of other causes. So again, the findings are going to be lower motor neuron type, like if the lesion is long lasting, there can be wasting of the muscles and there can be dysfunction of the involved muscle like radial nerve. It supplies the extensor of the wrist, so patient will have wrist drop. So this is how it works. This is all calculation, in fact, and if you have your background of neuroanatomy a little good, then it's going to help you a lot. Otherwise, it's going to be difficult. Now, neuromuscular junction. Neuromuscular junction, the typical example is myasthenia gravis. And the hallmark of neuromuscular junction is fatigability. When they exercise or they exert or they do some work, the muscle weakness start to weaken. The strength of the muscle decreases. And when they take rest, the strength is again normal. So this is what is fatigability. Fatigability is a hallmark. Weakness is proximal and symmetric, which is exacerbated with use, and it often affects the facial muscle also, like the patient of myasthenia can have ptosis, which worsens at the evening time. In morning, they usually don't have ptosis, and when the day passes, they notice that they are developing ptosis, and they develop weakness of the extraocular muscles also, which causes diplopia, and they have difficulty in getting from a squatting position, they have difficulty combing hair, difficulty in climbing the stair. What does it point towards? Weakness of the proximal muscle, the slack jaw, because there is weakness of the facial muscles as well. They have problem in chewing the food. And this worsens when these muscles are put to work. When they start having a meal, the chewing may be normal, but as they continue taking meals, gradually they feel the chewing has become difficult because the muscles, they are fatigued because of neuromuscular junction disease, that is myasthenia gravis. It's just an example. There are other diseases as well, like botulism, and we have one more. The other one is Lambert-Eaton syndrome. That is again an example of neuromuscular junction. Sensation are preserved. Reflexes are preserved. And there are no pathological reflexes, no upgoing plantars you will find in neuromuscular junction disease. And when you, again, we will start with the same scheme. And neurological examination and disorder of the neuromuscular junction. Now notice higher cortical functions normal. Cranial nerve. Now this looks like a cranial nerve abnormality, but this is not to cranial nerve pathology. This is because of the involvement of the muscles, of the eyelid muscles, of the facial muscles and the extraocular muscles. Neuromuscular junction disease, it can involve the skeletal muscles of any part of the body. So the cranial structures and the facial and all and eyelid muscle, they also come in the muscle. So this is not cranial nerve lesion actually, or cranial nerve deficit. The cranial nerve abnormalities or ptosis and all that you find because of fatigability of these muscles. Cerebellar function normal, motor fatigable proximal weakness in both upper and lower extremities, and sensory is normal, deep tendon reflexes are normal. For example, if a patient has come, no pathological reflexes, no Babinski. For example, if a patient has come and he is giving you complaints which are very typical of myasthenia, but at that time he is quite fine and you are unable to see any sign, what do you do? You induce fatigability. What do? You do a sustained up gaze and you ask him to look upwards constantly for at least 30 seconds. No, if the patient has myasthenia, he will develop ptosis with that sustained gaze, the muscle gets fatigued. And in the limb muscle fatigability checking, you can ask him or her to do sit-ups. They will start normally and they will exhaust very soon, very sooner than a normal person can do. So this is how you check for fatigability. Then last is muscle. Now muscle diseases, They also present with proximal arm and leg muscle weakness, and the weakness is usually symmetric. And sometimes what happens that there is involvement of facial muscles or extraocular and muscles of swelling also in certain muscle disorders, not in all. Like in inflammatory myopathies, you may have the muscle of swelling involved, polymyositis, dermatomyositis patient, they may have dysphagia. And then we have other muscle disorder like metabolic myopathies, and we have mitochondrial cytopathies which involve the facial muscles. So muscle disorders, congenital myopathies, yes, they can also involve the facial muscles and the eyelid muscles. Patient may have ptosis and they may have facial muscle weakness. The presentation typically is symmetrical proximal weakness, and they will not have any fatigability. Okay, sensation is normal, and problem is usually gradually progressive. And they can complain of cramping and aching, and there is no Babinski sign, no pathological reflexes. Again, cranial nerve ptosis. No, this is not due to cranial nerve abnormality. This is because of involvement of the muscles. Cerebellar function is normal, and proximal weakness in both upper and lower. Atrophy, fasciculation sometimes can occur. Sensory is normal. Deep tendon are preserved until late in the disease.